Friends, welcome for this One Person One Talk series. We are trying something new today. We have Professor Sivaji Chaudhary with vast experience in treating complicated trauma from Calcutta to talk about answers for transcervical fracture, and also he'll talk about his way of doing muscle pedicle bone grafting. We also have on the panel Dr. Jayant Sen, past Secretary of Rajasthan Orthopedic Association from Jaipur. He will be coordinating with us. He is a trauma surgeon interested in iliseo and foot and ankle surgeries. We also have Dr. Dinesh Kale from Belgaum in Karnataka. He is also a pelvi-acetabular surgeon. He has done a lot of workshops across India on this topic. We have Dr. Milind Joshi from Solapur, who is also a pelvi-acetabular surgeon as well as iliseo surgeon, a great volume surgeon from Solapur, treating many complicated cases here. So let's begin our today's talk by knowing more about our today's speaker, that is Dr. Sivaji Chaudhary.
Good evening.
Sir, one minute. I'll introduce you fully, sir.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Professor Sivaji Chaudhary did his graduation and undergraduation, but post-graduation, everything from Calcutta Medical College. As you can see, he has done his MBBS in 1976, then D. Ortho in 79 and MS Ortho in 1982. He also got himself trained in sports medicine. And after getting his master's, he started working as medical officer in West Bengal Health Services at Chanditala Rural Hospital in Hooghly District. He also then worked as registrar and clinical tutor in the Department of Orthopedic Surgery at Burdwan Medical College in Burdwan and R.G. Kerr Medical College in Calcutta between 1984 to 1990. Then he shifted back to as a specialist orthopedic surgeon in the West Bengal Health Services cadre, and he was posted at M.R. Bangur Hospital, Toliganj from 1990 to 2005 as a specialist orthopedic surgeon. Due to his personal reasons, he took voluntary retirement in 2005. Then, after his retirement, he joined KPC Medical College at Jadavpur, Calcutta as a assistant professor in the Department of Orthopedic Surgery. And since 2009, he's working there. At present, he's working as professor in the same medical college. Friends, Dr. Sivaji Chaudhary has a vast experience of tackling numerous variety of orthopedic cases and performing highly specialized operations. Today, he will share his vast knowledge in treating transcervical fracture and also about his way of doing muscle pedicle graft. And as I said earlier, these are the panelists we have today: Dr. Dinesh Kale from Belgaum, Dr. Milind Joshi from Solapur, Dr. Jayant Sen from Jaipur. We also have from Ortho TV Dr. Neeraj Bijlani and Dr. Ashok Shyam to coordinate and ask questions. Over to you, Dr. Sivaji Chaudhary.
Good evening. I'm extremely happy, and in fact, consider it a proud privilege to get this opportunity to share my work experience and opinion about in this field of orthopedic surgery, with which I have got more than 3 decades of experience, and it really fascinates me. At the outset, I convey my heartfelt gratitude to Dr. B. Shivshankar. All of you know his academic excellence, and also, apart from academic, he's a great orthopedic surgeon in various fields of orthopedics. So I'll come to my lecture, femoral neck fracture in quest of optimally efficient method of treatment. I do believe there is nothing called ideal in any science. Which is ideal today may become invalid 10 years down the line. So we are always looking for optimally efficient method of treatment. And the quest comes from the days of our junior residentialship as from house surgeonship. So we are very fortunate to get very great teachers in our junior residentialship. And the left hand side, you see.
Sir, Professor, you have to share your screen.
This one, yes. Just keep it on the first slide and restart your presentation.
Yes, sir.
Now you can start talking. So allow me to record.
Yeah, you can record.
The preliminary is already recorded. Introduction.
Yes, yes. Recorded, sir. Yeah.
So my topic in this evening is femoral neck fracture in quest of optimally efficient method of treatment. I said optimally efficient because I do believe there is nothing ideal in any medical science or whatever in the literature. What is ideal today may not be in vogue 10 years down the line. So in quest of optimally efficient method of treatment for last quarter of century in my career. So to quest, you have to have some gurus or mentors in the initial period of your life. So we are fortunate enough to get some legends in Indian orthopedic scenario as our teacher in the late 70s and early 80s. In the left hand side, you see Professor A.K. Dash, an exponent in polio surgery and cerebral palsy surgery and pediatric orthopedics. On the right hand side, you see legendary Professor Shailendra Bhattacharya. He has vast knowledge in every field of orthopedics. They are our great teachers at that time. Here you see Dr. M.S. Ghosh in the top and five of us at the bottom of the slide. He is our Guru Dronacharya in Eastern Railway Orthopedic Hospital. And from him, we learn the art of empathy. He told us every patient consider your relation, then the treatment will be normal. And on the left hand bottom slide, we are the Pancho Pandavs under his guidance. So under his guidance, and now middle three of us are still working in the same institution. On the left hand side, Dr. Dilip Sengupta, he is an overseas doctor and renowned spine surgeon all over the world. On the right hand side, Indrajit Sardar is a president of Arthroplastic Society of India. On the left hand side, you see Professor D.P. Bakshi. My today's lecture is somewhat related to his study. He used muscle pedicle bone graft in non-union or delayedly presented fractures of the neck of the femur. On the middle, you see untold, unsung hero in West Bengal orthopedic, Dr. N.C. Ghosh. And on the right hand side, Bhuvan Pal. We have a comparative study along with him. I'll come to it later on. And on the left hand side, you see Dr. Vishwajit Sen. He developed the condylocephalic nail. Probably before the Ender's nail was developed, he developed the condylocephalic nail and scapular neck osteotomy for recurrent dislocation of the shoulder. And to make you propel and make you enlightened, the undergraduate students are of innumerable value. We have got our postgraduate students, not undergraduate, and they are always buzzing with some questions and everything. Their theoretical knowledge is tremendous. So keep you uplift, they are very, very essential. So with this preliminary, I come to today's topic. Fractured femoral neck, as you all know, comprises about 20% volume of any trauma center, operative surgery trauma center. And of these, 50% are femoral neck fracture and rest other hip fractures. And of the fractures, some 10 to 15% are undisplaced fractures. And Rest of it are displaced structure or garden type 3 or type 4. For undisplaced structures, the treatment is very easy. Don't allow it to become displaced. Fix it as early as possible, irrespective of age of the patient. And for the displaced fracture, the treatment protocol differs according to the age of the patient. So it changes from time to time. This is from 2008, 11th edition of Campbell's Operative Orthopedic Surgery. It shows less than 65 years of age, community ambulator, close reduction, internal fixation, or if necessary. 65 to 75, community ambulator, CRIF. And if close reduction is not possible, do bipolar hemiarthroplasty. Less than 75, community ambulator, cemented bipolar arthroplasty. And total hip replacement were only reserved for pre-existent arthritis. And when the hip is normal, there is no question of total hip replacement. The scenario has changed. This is from Rockwood and Green textbook. And less than 60 years, no risk factors, reduction and fixation. More than 60 years of age, opinion is total hip replacement. And if it is already some hip problem is there, total hip replacement for the very beginning. I beg to differ from these things. So, Singh's osteoporotic index, in our own person, Singh has developed this. It is very nice. In my opinion, this is very nice. With this AP view of pelvis with both hips, you can very well know which is grossly osteoporotic and which one is not. If the index is 4, 5, and 6, irrespective of chronological age of the patient, we can consider him suitable for osteosynthesis in femoral neck fracture. But nowadays, the medico-legal problems are also there. And if your textbook doesn't support you to do osteosynthesis in elderly patient, you better can go for total hip replacement. Personally, I hate to do total hip replacement for any hip fracture. Total hip replacement should be reserved for diseased hip, not for fractured hip. Most of these fractures unite well, but chances of osteonecrosis is quite high, even after early operation. And till date, there is no definite method of prediction and prevention of osteonecrosis. Now, the prediction part is somewhat ascertained by doing advanced MRI and dynamic MRI. At 48 hours, they can predict, but there is no solution after prediction to prevent the development of osteonecrosis. So less than 60 years of age, osteosynthesis is the treatment of choice in displaced femoral neck fractures, garden 3 and 4. So this is a fracture sustained in a 60 years of old lady. The dilemma, which way will go? So that is, I said, this is still an unsolved fracture so far as treatment and results are concerned. Union rate, yes, reasonably good. Now, more than 90% union in almost all cases if you can do operation early. But osteonecrosis, in displaced fracture, it is 25% or more. In undisplaced fracture, it may be 5%. Prevention of osteonecrosis, is it possible? Let's proceed to see whether it is possible. Osteonecrosis, particularly in younger patients, results in severe morbidity. I'll show you slides later on. And the best way to tackle it is prevention. Vascularity of the femoral head is jeopardized in the majority of cases, displaced femoral neck fractures, and a vascularized bone graft may prevent the development of osteonecrosis. So this is a 35 years old man. You see garden 4 fracture, pelvis angle almost vertical. And the unique union, spherical head, and 5 years down the line, there is no avascular necrosis. How this can occur, I'll show you later on. This is a very favorable outcome in case of fracture femoral neck, displaced fracture femoral neck sustained by a young patient. And this is one unfavorable outcome. 41-year-old male patient, Garden 3 fracture, fracture united. You can see the fracture is united, but there is late segmental collapse and osteoarthrosis at the 3 years down the line. Now he is 44. At least he will need 2 total hip replacement in his life, and the life will not be the same after the operation of total hip replacement. Another case here, 7 years down the line, gross osteoarthrosis of the femur. Fortunately, this is elderly lady. She was operated upon at the age of 57. Now she is 64. Yes, with total hip replacement and curtailment of her daily activities will allow the hip to survive for the rest of her life. And this is one prescription. 4 days back, the patient sustained intracapsular fracture neck of the femur. The surgeon advising total hip replacement. This is a very unfortunate situation. Total hip replacement in 42 years old male patient should be reserved for diseased hip, not for a fractured hip. But to avoid complications, to avoid non-union, to avoid osteonecrosis, some of are doing total hip replacement even at the age of 40. I'll show how to prevent it and how the patient can go bad with this total hip replacement. So the vascular supply of the femoral head, we all know, comes from the mainly capsular vessels and some from the endosteal vessels from here. Endosteal vessels, intraosseous vessels, and mainly through capsular vessels and through the ligamentum teres, very, very few, almost negligible supply of blood. And mind it, this show very carefully. I'll talk to you later on. The capsular vessels are known as epiphyseal arterial group. The lateral epiphyseal vessel is the main supply of to the head of the femur. And this is the medial circumflex femoral artery. And later on, when we'll do capsulotomy and slot over the femoral head, we'll cut the capsule here. We'll not danger the lateral epiphyseal artery. We'll take the graft from here. It will not danger the medial circumflex femoral artery. So when there is a fracture femoral neck, the capsular vessels are kinked. And when the vessels are kinked, the arterial supply to the head of the femur is jeopardized. That's why urgency of operation is declared. If we can do operation urgently within 6 to 8 hours time, or at best by 12 hours time, the chances of osteonecrosis becomes lessened. Even then, doing operation at a very early hour, the osteonecrosis from the 75%, it was reduced to 18.5%, but not totally evaded. So fracture healing is interfered by synovial bathing of the fracture. Femoral neck essentially has no periosteal layer. Angiogenic inhibiting factor in the synovial fluid. Precarious blood supply of the femoral head. Displaced femoral head neck fractures were unlikely to unite unless the fracture is stabilized. And the stabilization started in 1860s only with the silver pins used by von Langenberg. But he was unlucky at that time. No antibiotic, no sterilization, and the procedure went into disrepute due to infection and failure. Smith Peterson with tri-flange nail started from 1925. Then there are various methods of treatment, and now the fracture neck femur is caused by rotational violence, you all know. So at least 2 to 3 pins should be given to prevent the rotation. No single pin. Mary Cato in 1965 done a histological study of 109 femoral neck fractures 16 days after the fracture in displaced fracture, and found all of the head of the femur becomes avascular 16 days after the fracture. So this is a huge magnitude of avascular necrosis of the femoral head. Garden showed if the alignment index can be properly maintained, the chance of union and avascular necrosis will be lessened. And these are the various articles in the literature. So in young patients, 50 years old or less, in young adults, so in the studies of 85 and 76, it was almost 70%, 75%. Now, Sounsky and others in 1984 did very early operation, and the avascular necrosis or osteonecrosis was reduced to around 19%. Even then, 19% is quite high. The role of percentage doesn't hold good for a person who is affected. For him, it is 100%. You can say it is 19%, but for him, it is 100%. Mayers did the open reduction and internal fixation and muscle pedicle bone grafting in 150 cases presented in 1973. 89% cases of union was there, and AVN rate was only 8 to 9%. Our professor, Dr. D.P. Bakshi, delayed done open reduction, internal fixation in ununited femoral neck fracture. If a fracture presents 3 to 4 weeks after the fracture, he called it ununited fracture and did muscle pedicle bone graft. And from him, we have come to know about the muscle pedicle bone graft, and we are doing open reduction muscle pedicle bone grafting for delayed presented cases and non-union of the fractured neck femur in young adult patient. So this is me, Chaudhary Shivaji. Treatment of displaced femoral neck fractures by close reduction, internal fixation along with quadratus femoris muscle pedicle bone grafting. In 2008 Indian Journal of Orthopedics January-March issue, I presented 73 cases. The age of the patient ranged from 23 to 81, and 2 to 6 years follow-up showed no evidence of avascular necrosis in a single patient. And as a original work, quadratus femoris muscle pedicle bone graft, after close reduction and internal fixation, I got the Silver Jubilee Commemoration Gold Medal from West Bengal Orthopedic Association. So, how I came to doing this muscle pedicle bone graft for a fresh closed fracture? So, you see, 14th April 1996, it was a Bengali New Year's Day, and this was a 31-year-old male patient. The other limb was post-polio residual paralysis affected, and only the right side is normally functioning. And 7 days prior to death, one of my patients, whom I did operation 3 years back with multiple pinning, came to me with frank avascular necrosis of the femoral head and osteoarthritis. I was rather worried. Now he was 43. And he is definitely going to have 2 total hip replacement in his lifetime. Life will not remain the same. So on that day, I was going to do this operation in a very good nursing home. I immediately told the anesthetist, "Would you mind giving the anesthesia in prone position?" Madam said, "No, you can do in prone position. The patient is rather fit for operation." So this is garden 4 fracture, and this is the first day when all on a sudden I started doing close reduction, internal fixation, and then opening the capsule and doing the muscle reduction, muscle pedicle bone graft. So this is not the same patient. This is a different patient. So this is in prone position. You see the all the orientation is different. The limb is externally rotated. That is internal rotation in the hip joint. And in abduction, in extension, and in prone position with the availability of the C-arm. So I have already told this M. Singh Nagarin, this is our own people, joined JBES American volume. They showed osteoporotic index. And to my mind, age is a number. You see, Leander Pace is playing tennis. competitive tennis at the age of 43, 44. Roger Federer at the age of 38 is aspiring for another Grand Slam title. Sachin Tendulkar played cricket till the age of 40. And we can see a lot of enthusiastic patients, persons, even at the age of 80, doing all sorts of activities, more than daily activities, playing golf and other things, everything. So the age is a number. If you consider the patient is fit enough, I still go in for fixation, osteosynthesis of the femoral neck fracture. If I get the patient into true confidence, he will not sue me afterwards for the second operation if it fails. So this is the case. At this is a 34-year male patient, Garden 3 fracture. One thing is that we should not compromise with the quality of reduction. Slightest compromise in the quality of reduction, slightest errors in the reduction, and aberration from 180 degree in the lateral view will lead to failure. So this has to be very carefully monitored. This is Singh's Garden's alignment index, and this is Lowell's S and reverses. No kink should be there. It should be 180 degree, and the neck shaft angle should be normal. Slight amount of valgus is allowable, but slightest varus is not at all accepted. Slight valgus acceptable, normal 180 degree in the lateral view. And this is the outline of the operative procedure. It starts, I'll come to you later on. And before opening the gluteus maximus, splitting the vastus lateralis, the fixation of the femoral neck is done. Then we identify the quadratus femoris insertion, and then we'll look the quadratus femoris insertion, and then we'll put in the slot on the head of the femur. So quadratus femoris sutured with the capsule in the head of the femur. This is the quadratus femoris in the head of the femur. This is from the donor side. So we have to be very careful about this medial circumflex femoral artery, and we have to be very careful about the anatomy of the posterior aspect of the neck and head of the femur. And cadaveric dissection is very handy if you can practice it for this operation, one or two practice only. So this is the incision line. It starts, it is 12 centimeter long incision, starts 2 to 3 centimeter proximal to the greater trochanter and little medial, coming across the greater trochanter to the shaft of the femur. The fracture and the cannulated hisco in inverted V shape, the lower one, low central, and the upper two, anterior and posterior. After doing the cannulated hisco, we have closed the vastus lateralis to minimize the paraoperative bleeding. I can assure you, no patient needs any blood transfusion if it is physiologically fit for operation. This is the anatomical figure from Grant's anatomy, the quadratus femoris. And I tell you, the quadratus femoris is absent in about 1% of cases. From 1996 till date, I have done more than 180 cases of close reduction, internal fixation, and muscle pedicle bone grafting. In 3 cases, I have found there was no quadratus femoris, and all of them are female patients. So only CHS was done. So quadratus femoris may be absent in some cases. The percentage is very less, but may be absent. So this is how the quadratus femoris is delineated by a very narrow bone lever after the closure of the vastus lateralis. There is a bursa over the trochanteric region, cut out the bursa and delineate the quadratus femoris. Quadratus femoris. Now take the bone graft. The graft, length of the graft depends on the base of insertion of the quadratus femoris. It is about 2.5 to 2 centimeters, and you go 1 centimeter proximal. If you go 1 centimeter proximal, you can taper that part, denude of soft tissue, and can nicely fit in into the slot made into the head of the femur. And it is 1 centimeter wide and 1 centimeter broad. If you make it broader, it will affect the medial circumflex femoral artery. But if you make it thinner and narrower, the graft may break. And if the graft breaks, your whole procedure is jeopardized. So it should be very careful taking out the graft. You have to save the medial circumflex femoral artery. At the same time, you have to have a graft of reasonable size and strength so that it does not break while inserted into the head of the femur. So after taking the graft and it was displaced medially, in the superior part, there are gamelli superior and inferior, and the medial side with the two bone levers. And with the artery forceps, you can find the medial circumflex femoral artery is delineated and shown. A medial circumflex artery is delineated and shown with the artery forceps. And now the capsule of the hip joint is explored. Now you will incise the capsule of the hip joint in an L-shaped manner. The horizontal limb of the L comes downwards to safeguard the lateral epiphyseal vessel. And once the capsule is incised, you can find the head of the femur. So this is the head of the femur, and we have done a stay suture with the vicryl number 1 to the capsule to anchoring the graft later on in the slot. So this is the slot made in the head of the femur. So the graft is inserted into the head of the femur. This is a Garden 4 fracture femoral neck in the 59 years old lady. Now we'll proceed with the video.
59 year old male patient sustained fracture femoral neck right side of Garden type 4 yesterday and prepared for OT this morning. He was given spinal anesthesia and the fracture reduction is done in the fracture table in prone position and in extension, and it is checked in the image intensive TV. Now
I'll tell you a little bit about the fracture reduction. In extended position, orientation is always reversed. We put in 30 degree of abduction and give traction in longitudinal axis. This traction reduces the varus deformity and the varus is gone. Now we check it in the lateral view. True lateral view is only possible in the fracture table. And with the lateral view, if we find the position of the head, if it has posterior or the neck is posterior, and push the thigh, upper part of the thigh upwards, that goes posterior. And by that method, we can achieve a perfect reduction.
Well, 12 centimeter long incision is given, which starts a little above the greater trochanter and goes downwards. Now, after cutting the tensor fasciolator, the vastus lateralis is explored and split. And two bone levers are placed on sides, and a standard cannulated hip screw was done for fixation of the fracture in a V-shaped manner. And it is checked in the image intensifier TV. Now this distal part of the incision is closed to minimize the bleeding. And now we'll go on exploring the proximal part of the incision and explore the proximal part of the incision, and the quadratus femoris muscle is delineated. Now we'll show the exact extent of the muscle pedicle graft. It starts a little above the insertion of the quadratus femoris and stops just above the lesser trochanter. You show the incision line is being marked, and now with the help of straight and curved osteotome, the graft will be taken, harvested, and it is about 3 centimeter long and wide, 1 centimeter wide and 1 centimeter deep. The graft is being harvested with the help of carved and straight osteotom, and you see the graft is harvested, and of this length and width graft, it does not injure the medial circumflex femoral artery, and the graft will now be mobilized medially with the finger dissection. You see the mobilization of the graft by finger dissection. And now bone levers will be placed on the medial side of the neck of the femur and on the lateral side, that is on the lower part and the upper border. And with the bone levers placed, now we'll find the capsule of the hip joint. It is a bluish white structure. The capsule of the hip joint is now delineated properly. Now we'll incise the capsule of the hip joint at the junction of the head and neck, and to find the head of the femur. Now you can see the head of the femur after cutting the capsule of the hip joint. Now we will apply stay suture in the capsule of the hip joint, so that with that stay suture we can secure the graft later on in the slot of the femoral head. Now stay suture is applied and the graft from the...
Now you see the graft and the shiny articular surface of the femoral head is shown. This is a small, very small part of the femoral head with the shiny articular surface of the femur.
The femoral head is taken out. You can see the articular surface of the head of the femur and the cortical bone in the head of the femur. And now you can visualize the slot in the head of the femur. And now we'll taper the harvested graft, tensor muscle pedicle graft from the quadratus femoris. And after tapering and denuding all soft tissue from the proximal side of the graft, prepared graft, we'll insinuate into the slot. And you can see it is placed in the slot and nicely fitted in the slot. Now we'll anchor it with the stay suture, Vicryl number 1, so that the graft becomes stabilized. And these anchoring sutures are given with the quadratus femoris muscle and the capsule of the hip joint. And after suturing the capsule with the quadratus femoris muscle, we'll find this is absolutely stabilized, and now we have to apply gel foam at the donor site to minimize the postoperative bleeding. Now gel foam will be applied at the donor site. You see the donor site, and gel foam is applied at the donor site, and now the wound will be closed in layers.
The postoperative regimen.
Sibaji sir. I have got a question. Since you are anyway opening the fracture site to put the graft, why to fix the fracture first? Or if there is any problem, if you don't fix the fracture with CC screw first? Or the third part is whether you have seen a case where the fracture has been fixed with the CC screw when you opened it for muscle pedicle graft, did you see any displacement? These are some of the questions I have got.
The fracture site is never open. Fracture site is never open. It is
okay. Only the head.
Only the head. Only the head. Fracture site is never open.
Okay. That
totally closed
clears my that clears my doubt. So then I have another
question. It is not open reduction. Never open reduction.
Okay. I have got another question. Since you have vast experience of reducing this fracture neck femur both in supine position and prone position,
yes,
which you feel easier to get the reduction? Because in supine position we always see that the shaft is sagging down and reduction is a bit difficult. Whether this position helps in getting a better reduction?
That is the problem. The shaft goes down, that is, it goes posterior. I have already said after you put it in, put the foot plate in the foot plate, you secure the foot part of the patient, yes, and then give longitudinal traction in 30 degree of abduction.
Okay.
That reduces the varus. And now, with a proper lateral view, in only fractured table, you can get a proper lateral view. Otherwise, proper lateral view is not possible.
Yes.
In that proper lateral view, we see the whether the shaft part is going posterior. If it goes posterior, you lift it up. And then do internal rotation and reduce the abduction angle to 20 degrees. I do not find any such problem in supine or prone position. And nowadays, my OT staffs and everyone are accustomed in prone position. They know Shivaji sir is operating in a fracture neck femur CHS. Unless it is an undisplaced fracture, I have never done for last 25 years any osteosynthesis without muscle pedicle bone graft in a displaced femoral neck.
Okay. Yes, Dr. Dinesh Kale has a question, sir.
Please.
First thing is, you have said when you place the patient in a prone position, the femur is going to sag anteriorly. It will not sag posteriorly.
Yes. Second, anteriorly. That is why I am saying you have to push it up.
Okay. Second thing.
The orientation is totally reverse.
If your fracture is unreduced, how do you reduce the fracture?
It is absolutely very, very difficult. In fracture femoral, it is not a trochanteric fracture. In fracture femoral neck, intracapsular fracture, open reduction is equally difficult if you cannot reduce it by closed method. In a fresh fracture, if you are not able to reduce it by closed method, open reduction is not very easy. Can be done, no problem. You have to open it up, everything in the capsule from the posterior aspect, and then with some joystick and others, you can do an open reduction, but open reduction is not an easy job if you fail in closed reduction.
No, that is my successful question was, fine, you got a closed reduction, even if it's a fresh fracture, sometimes you end up in a difficulty not getting a closed reduction. With your approach, do you attempt to open and reduce, use some KYs as a joystick and be satisfied that your fracture is reduced? Then you fix
always. I am satisfied with the fracture is reduced, both in Lowell's reverse SNS. I have already told, slightest varus will lead you to non-union. Slightest varus. If you accept a little bit of varus, it will go to non-union.
So how many times do you have to do an open reduction of the fracture in this
position? Not even in 1% of cases. I have said by this time, in last 25 years, I have done 180 cases. You have to adjust a little bit, you push the femoral head up, a little bit of abduction. You can have a very good reduction if it is a fresh fracture. Fresh fracture means we are operating all these cases within 48 hours of fracture. And the second thing, the role of anesthetist is very important because we cannot do it within 12 hours because pre-anesthetic checkup is very important. We are doing in prone position, the patient's foot is secured with the foot plate, and if need be, any emergency situation arises, patient has to be made supine as early as possible. So it is anesthetist continuous constant watch that is very much needed for this operation in prone position.
So what I get from you is that you are aiming at closed reduction only.
Yes, closed reduction only, and in 1% of cases, if it fails, with the joysticks, as you said, K-wire, I'll go for closed reduction, open, then internal fixation, and then go for muscle pedicle.
Okay, the original paper on muscle pedicle, the graft was put at the neck area and was fixed with a screw. Here, you are removing a part of the head.
Yes.
And after removing you have taken a 3 centimeter graft.
3 centimeter graft.
And the cutout in the head is about a centimeter.
Yes. About the 3 centimeter graft. I'm telling you, only the insertion of the quadratus femoris and you go 1 centimeter proximal, that part has to be denuded of soft tissue, only bony tissue, tapered, and then it will fix. If the soft tissue goes into the head of the femur, the fixation will not be secured. The bony part, no muscle, devoid of soft tissue, has to go inside the head of the femur.
Now the results, of course, with so much number of cases, the results of yours have been excellent. But what I'm not able to understand is, there is a fracture in the neck of the femur and you are putting a graft in the head of the femur.
Avasculity occurs in the head of the femur.
Agreed.
This is avasculity to prevent the avasculity.
This is a muscle pedicle graft. Quadratus femoris, quadratus femoris is a very thick muscle.
Yes.
It is a very, very muscularized pedicle graft. Sartorius is not good. In supine position, you can do. And in avascular necrosis, idiopathic avascular necrosis, we are accustomed with doing tensor fasciolator muscle pedicle graft. Graft in fracture femoral neck operation is a very, very messy operation, I can say.
Have you ever encountered failure of your fixation of the neck?
Yes, a failure of fixation neck. I'll come to you later and the union rate is about 95%. I said, now I am very, very much skeptic. Slightest varus, I will not accept. A very slight varus. It is well within the guidance alignment index. We can go for fixation. Even slightest varus will lead you to non.
Neeraj, do you have a question? You had raised the hand. Anyway, I have one more question. Anyway, you are putting the graft into the head. Why not across the fracture site? Because it will also help the fracture to unite.
No, there is a very, very, very risk. There is a, if we the medial circumflex femoral artery.
Okay.
If you open the fracture, you do not know. You may injure the medial circumflex femoral artery inadvertently. And if you injure the medial circumflex femoral, the whole purpose of the operation will be jeopardized.
Okay, sir.
Never use it. In case of open reduction and when closed reduction fails, you take graft from the posterior iliac crest and put graft, reconstitute the neck of the femur. And that case, the graft is already fixed in the neck of the femur. In that case, we fix the graft with the screw to the neck of the femur.
Okay. In the head, you make a slot using a curette, you take out the bone from the head, or you use an osteotome to take out the bone from the head?
This is a very, very goldsmith's job. We take very small osteotome, small size osteotome. Then with very, very small osteotome, careful carpentry is absolutely necessary in this part of the job.
Okay. Since the graft is partly within the head and partly over the neck, the neck size becomes larger. Does it impinge on the margin of the acetabulum sometime?
No, it is in the middle of the neck. It is not going proximally. So it will never impinge the acetabulum. Never impinge the acetabulum.
Okay, sir.
Part of your graft is going to remain outside the slot that you have created.
Yes. Part of the graft will remain outside the slot. And that is the part attached with the muscle. Graft attached with the muscle, it cannot go inside the slot.
Now, suppose you have a scenario, the patient comes to you at the end of 3 days with a displaced neck femur. What do you do?
Sir, I am nowadays, I'll go into the comparative study. To me, if the patient is less than 60 years of age, even if he comes at 3 months after the fracture, I'll give him a counseling. Do you want total hip replacement or do you allow me to do muscle pedicle bone graft? Your hip will be absolutely normal if it succeeds. If it fails, I'll go total hip replacement.
No, I agree.
I hate total hip replacement for a normal hip joint. Merely for fracture, I'll never do total hip replacement.
My question is, patient has come to you at the end of 3 days, the neck is displaced, and then you will be doing an open reduction of the neck posteriorly.
No. At 3 days, you can go for closed reduction. No problem. Okay. 3 days, I have said, at 7 days, 10 days, up to 12, 2 weeks, closed reduction is possible.
Okay, sir.
What is your point against a supine position, anterior approach to the hip, reduce the fracture, and fix it? Why are you against that?
No. I am not against it. I am doing a muscle pedicle graft at the same sitting. Okay. So, anterior fixation, your choice of muscle pedicle is only sartorius. Sartorius is not a good muscle pedicle. Very long muscle. The muscle pedicle, vascularized pedicle itself is weak. It may not give a vascularity to the head of the femur for the rest of his life. That is why I am not doing in
all your DHS you are doing, I mean all your neck femurs you are doing in prone position.
All.
Yes. There is a question from Dr. Milind Joshi. He wants to know what is the size of the screw which you put to fix the graft.
No. Nowadays we are not fixing the graft with the screw. Earlier we used to fix the graft with the screw. I will show you the X-rays.
Okay. 38 millimeter
screw.
Okay. That is that. What is that? 2.5 or 3.5 millimeter? 2.7 or 3.5 screw?
3.5.
Okay, sir. You can proceed now.
So the post-operative regime, I have nothing to tell you. This is as good as a normal CHS patient. And with the muscle pedicle graft, you are very sure that your graft is secured properly and nicely. You can go with the post-operative regime as normal as a normal CHS done. So I am not going into details about it. From every 3 to 6 months till 2 years, and then after every 1 year. So this is the first case in 1996, the garden floor and almost vertical pulse angle. I have already told 31-year-old male patient, other limb is post polio affected limb. So 12 years down the line, at that time I used to fix the graft with the screw. I have already told you 38 millimeter screw, 3.5 screw, 38 millimeter. And now at the 12 years down the line, you see the fracture line is nicely healed fracture. No evidence of avascular necrosis is being all routine activities. And now you can see, if you look very carefully, indistinct, this patient is of 80 years of age. He is my next door neighbor, uncle. In 2002, he was 81-year-old male patient. He is doing gardening at his rooftop at the third floor, next to my building. So he has sustained the garden type 4 fracture femoral neck. I said, uncle, counseling, I'll try to reduce your fracture, do muscle pedicle and bone grafting. If it fails, I'll do prosthesis. Do you agree or not? He said, Shivaji, you do whatever you like best for me. And he himself is from pharmaceutical company, regional director was there, agreed to that. And you see the result. The graft, you can see in the lateral view, the graft is fixed with a 38 millimeter screw. And 10 years down the line, nicely healed fracture, no evidence of avascular necrosis. You can see the screw fitting the graft. That time, and I used to do with multiple nose pin to have the operation do very, very fast. And he was intending to do, being the first centurion of our area of Lake Gardens, but unfortunately he died last year. But for 18 years down the line, 17 years down the line, he was doing all routine activities. He used to walk 4 or 5 kilometers every year during the pujas, pandal hopping during the pujas in Kolkata. You do not know how difficult it is, but he did, and said, Shivaji, you done a miracle for me. I am very, very lucky. I didn't have the prosthesis. Some of my friends have prosthesis and they cannot do everything as I do, as I am doing. So this is one thing. So this is my next door neighbor, uncle. He died at the age of 99. And this is the eldest lady in my group. I said the Shink's osteoporotic index is my only criteria. Physiological age. Chronological age is no criteria. But nowadays, I'm rather skeptic. If someone sues me, I cannot show any textbook supporting my operation at the age of 70, 75 or 80. This lady was 65 years old and this operation was done. Oldest lady in my group. So this was nicely united fracture. And you see, doing all routine activities 5 years down the line, this is the incision mark showed in her bottom. Another case. So, as I've already told you, from November 2009, I am in the KPC Medical College Hospital. And I was always doing, and I said, I have not done any osteosynthesis in displaced femoral neck fracture without adding muscle pedicle bone graft for last 24, 25 years. I always do it muscle pedicle bone graft. In undisplaced fracture, no muscle pedicle bone graft, only in supine position fixation. And my other colleagues were not doing muscle pedicle bone graft. Okay, from November 2009, we are doing these things. And in 2017, we did a retrospective comparative study. I'll show you this later on and coming slides. And nowadays, I cannot do any comparative study because all my colleagues are doing muscle pedicle bone graft whenever they are doing osteosynthesis for femoral neck fracture. They are so much influenced with the fine result of this procedure. So this is our institution in Jadavpur, KPC Medical College, Kolkata, in Kolkata. So exclusion criteria. I am doing muscle pedicle bone grafting even after 48 hours for this retrospective comparative study. Those cases are excluded from this present statistical data. Physiologically active and less than 60 years of age with good osteoporotic index, I'm still doing close and open reduction, internal fixation, muscle pedicle bone graft. Additional bone graft from posterior iliac crest if necessary. Physiologically active, more than 60 years of age, total hepatoplasty, and exclusion is pediatric patients. Patients reporting early, but life expectancy less than 5 years, hemiarthroplasty with existing pathology in hip, like ankylosing spondylitis, we did THA. I reserved THA only for diseased hip, not for a fractured neck femur. With close reduction could not be achieved, that are excluded from this study because it is a study of close reduction. And quadratus femoris muscle found absent. In this study at KPC Medical College, only one female patient, we found it absent. And Shing's osteoporotic index 1 to 3. This means osteoporotic. Unsuitable for anesthesia and prone position. I have already explained. In prone position, anesthesia in fracture table is a difficult proposition for the anesthetist. If need be, they cannot be made supine very early. So results, period of follow-up, 2 years to 9 years. Bony union in group 1, that is only CHS, 42 out of 45, and group 2, 43 out of 45. Non-union, slightest varus will lead you to non-union. I am repeatedly saying this. From 1 year onwards, we looked for evidence of aseptic necrosis, both clinically and radiologically, by appearance of pain and restriction of movements, and in X-ray changes of bone density and sclerotic patches. In 2 to 9 years follow-up, we did not get a single case of osteonecrosis, and 43 cases we could follow up for more than 2 years, group 2. In group 1, there are 7 cases of osteonecrosis, that is 16.27%. The rate of union were almost identical, about 94%. This is hip modified Harris hip scoring system, pain, limb support, distance walk, stair climbing, put on shoes, socks, sitting, absence of deformity, leg length discrepancy, range of motion. Pain has got the maximum number and limb. So it was found excellent in 35 cases, good in 7, and those 2 cases where it was went into non-union, definitely there was a poor in group where muscle pedicle bone graft was added. So these are a few results. This is a 55-year-old lady, Garden 5 type fracture, Powell's angle is right. So immediate postoperative, 3 years down the line, and it is 7 years down the line. There is slight collapse at the neck, the slight backing out of the nails. You see the graft in the lateral view, still in situ in the head of the femur. This is the rest of the graft. It will never impinge in the acetabulum. Dr. Shivshankar, you are saying whether it will impinge in the acetabulum or not, it will never impinge in the acetabulum. It is in the head of the femur and rest of it is lying in the neck of the femur.
Thank you. Thank you for reminding that, sir. Really. Yeah. Thank you.
So this is a 35-year-old male patient. So once again, you can see the graft in the lateral view. One other young patient, Garden 3 type of fracture, slight valgus accepted, nice union, no evidence of avascular necrosis in 5 years down the line. Once again, you can see the muscle pedicle there. Another case, another case, the muscle pedicle, you see. This one is the pedicle in the inside the head of the femur. And this is one of my colleagues' case, Dr. B.M. Pal, Professor B.M. Pal. This one, this was a 40 years old male patient. The fracture nicely united, but 3 years down the line, segmental collapse and aseptic necrosis of the femoral head. And at the age of 43, he will need two total hip replacement in his lifetime, and with curtailment of activities of daily life. Once again, multiple nodes, multiple CHS, once again leading to avascular necrosis in 4 years down the line. So fractures of the femoral neck degrade and disrupt the femoral head perfusion in multiple ways. Displaced cervical fractures must disrupt all intraosseous blood supply from the neck, leaving only surviving subsynovial ascending arteries and contribution from ligament anteries, if any. Early operation, stable internal fixation by multiple pin screws has increased the rate of union remarkably well during the last century. The DRLI has shown almost 100% rate of union. And it is almost 90% plus. We have got the same idea, 90% plus. But incidence of avascular necrosis continued to be high, and more so in younger patients. In younger patients, the magnitude of trauma during the fracture of the femoral neck is much high. So the pulse angle is almost inevitably more vertical in garden fork type fracture in young patients. So in meta-analysis, it was found osteonecrosis remains 23% for displaced femoral neck fracture. Pre-operative assessment of the femoral head vascularity is uncertain and still remains avascular. Dynamic MRI, advanced MRI, all sorts of things are doing within 48 hours, after 48 hours. So can say this is more than 50% of the head are going to be avascular, but no clue the treatment option for this one. So they are saying by dynamic magnetic resonance, 36 cases, 19 patients are developed osteonecrosis. Presence of bleeding from the drill holes of the cannulated screw was observed for 5 minutes. It is true. If there is good bleeding, probably the head is good. And there are other cases, osteonecrosis, even after within 24 hours, 25% cases of osteonecrosis. And bulgarization osteotomy can improve the union rate, but the evidence of avascular necrosis still remains high. Fibular graft, even a vascular fibular graft in idiopathic avascular necrosis, I think is a debatable value. Urgent operation does not guarantee against AVM. Number of cases, number of literature, number of shown that urgent operation still leads to 20 to 25% cases of AVM in young adults. Microangiographic and histological studies to a procedure could maintain the vascularity and viability of the femoral head. Mayer's technique of open reduction and internal fixation may endanger the medial circumflex artery. That's why the Mayer's operation gone into disrepute. He published his paper in 1973, and Professor Bokshi has published his paper in 1986. And during the 13 years and more so in decades, this Mayer's operation was not reproducible by other orthopedic surgeons. Because of some difficulty, there is danger of injuring the medial circumflex artery is still there. Capsular decompression by aspiration or by capsulotomy is debatable, but by default we are doing it because we are doing this operation within 48 hours and we are opening the capsule in the proximal part of the capsule at the head neck junction. And in most of our cases, we have found some bleeding coming out after opening up the capsule. So capsular decompression to prevent that tamponade effect is already done in our cases. So once again, I am going to the Campbell's operative procedure of surgery. 2008, after 75 years, go for CRIF. And nowadays, it has cut short, less than 60 years. more than 60 years, go for total hip replacement. Close reduction, internal fixation, quadratus femoris, muscle pedicle gonadotropin. Simple, very simple. You see the video thrice and you can do, everyone can do. It is simpler than doing intercondylar fracture of the femur or intercondylar fracture of the tibia. I say if the bicondylar fracture, you are opening the upper part of the tibia medially and laterally, it is much more difficult, and an extensile exposure of the femur is much more difficult than this operation. And a good PMR for a 1 year old child with telepsy cuneiforme is much more difficult than doing this operation. So this is not at all a difficult operation. An average orthopedic surgeon can do it. Whether this procedure can prevent osteonecrosis or not can only be ascertained producing results in the hands of other surgeon using the same procedure for a considerable period. As I said, in our institution, now there is no possibility of comparative study because all are doing muscle pedicle bone. I helped them in the initial procedures. Now they are doing it of their own with the help of our postgraduate students. So this patient is only 34 years old. This is a patient of one of our senior colleague, Dr. Pratyush Chatterjee. He called me that you please do this operation. So I did this internal fixation and muscle pedicle bone grafting immediate postoperative, and it is 2.5 years down the line, nicely united, no evidence of avascular necrosis. Now listen to what Dr. Pratyush Chatterjee is saying.
Good evening. I am Dr. Pratyush Chatterjee, past president of the West Bengal Orthopedic Association. As orthopedic surgeons, we all know about the problem of femoral neck fractures. Particularly if the patient is young. In elderly patients, we do hip replacement, either total or partial, whatever. But if the patient is a young patient, hip replacement is definitely not the answer. And we have been searching for a viable option for these patients in femoral neck fractures. I have no hesitation in saying that my good friend and one-time colleague, Dr. Shivaji Choudhury, has probably is on the right path in finding out a solution. He does quadratus femoris muscle pedicle bone graft in fresh fractures in all young patients. Sometimes back, both of us, myself and Dr. Choudhury, were faculties in the at KPC Medical College in Kolkata. When I once invited Dr. Choudhury to perform this surgery upon one of my patients, I was present in the OT then. I saw him doing this surgery. That patient got well, and thereafter, being convinced, I started myself doing this surgery even in my private patients. The first case that I did sometimes back, I consulted Dr. Choudhury, and he sent me very generously the total video of the entire operating procedure. Not only this, he also sent one of his postgraduate trainees to assist me in the theater. Thereafter, I have been doing it in all my cases. I am convinced about the efficacy of this particular procedure. Avascular necrosis has largely been could be avoided after this surgery. I'm really convinced about this efficacy, and as a senior orthopedic surgeon, I would recommend this particular procedure of quadratus femoris muscle pedicle bone graft in fresh fractures in younger patients. Thank you very much.
Now you see this patient. His only fault that he sustained a femoral neck fracture at a very early age of 19 years of age. Now he's 43 years. So it was fixed. 3 years down the line, it developed osteonecrosis. Total hip replacement was done. As because 3 years down the line, he was only 22 years old. At the age of 22, we cannot just restrict the activities too much. He went on doing normal routine activities. There was aseptic loosening of the femoral head and as a femoral cup and also the stem. Revision, total hip was done. With that revision, total hip, when he was cycling, he had a fall and this was the result. And now he was not able to find enough money to go for a ACRM fracture everywhere. By that time, it was the fracture was more and more separated. He came to us in this condition. The stem is totally out. So this was the condition. It took 3.5 hours for us to do the ACRM total hip replacement. To negotiate the stem in this huge fracture of the shaft of the femur was a real problem. And now he's 43 only. At 19 years of age, he sustained femoral neck fracture, done one total hip, done revision total hip, done re-revision total hip with ACRM. And I have told him, you never ride a bicycle in the rest of your life. He's a worker in a factory, and I don't know how long he will be able to go in public transport and other things. So total hip replacement is not an answer for femoral neck fracture, but it was not done initially. Unfortunately, this thing happened, and that could be avoided by this muscle pedicle bone graft. I really assert it. And once again, you see the plight of this total hip replacement. 42 years age, total hip replacement was advised. That should not be done. You can. There are lots of other procedures. Even a McMurray's osteotomy will give, though it is obsolete now, give a better result. You can do total hip replacement after McMurray, no problem. So, how many times can surgeon not see before the hip joint perish? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind.
Many times can a surgeon not see before the hip joint perish? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
It was the voice of my daughter. He's a neurophysician. He did the share the Bob Dylan song for me. Okay. Now I'll tell you, and on the fag end of my story, the story of two gynecologists. This one, a 57-year-old gynecologist, very reputed female gynecologist in this in our city. She sustained femoral neck fracture in her batch picnic and was immediately taken to a very good private hospital by one of her batchmates, a renowned orthopedic surgeon, he is no more. Cemented bipolar hemiarthroplasty was done. For 2 years, she was all right. And then there is aseptic loosening. Then she didn't rely upon Kolkata surgeons. She went to Mumbai and uncemented total hip was done. There was a fracture and repeated dislocation. And she was advised to use abduction device at bedtime and use a shoelace on the opposite side during her walking and walking with a cane. She came to me at this stage, not for any medical advice. She was disgusted with orthopedic surgeons. And I was too junior. It is a story all time, all 25 years back. She came to me for a handicap certificate because she was a very, very leading gynecologist. And for last 2 years, she was not able to do practice, and income tax people was not after her. What is that? So she sought a handicap certificate from me. So a muscle pedicle bone graft could save a person from getting a handicap certificate. And this is the story of my friend, my batchmate, once again a gynecologist in North Bengal, Islampur area. In our batch picnic, he sustained this garden type 4 fracture femoral neck. And he was taken to my hospital, KPC Medical College, with our friends. And I said, Balaram, you are 63 years of age. I am not going to do total hip replacement for you. Please bear with me. I'll do this operation just described. And if it fails, you may need a second operation, but most likely it will not fail. So we did. So this is 5 years down the line. 5 years down the line, once again, you can see the vascularized pedicle graft. And now you listen what Balaram is saying.
Good evening. I am Dr. Balaram Sinha, a practicing gynecologist from North Bengal and a classmate of Dr. Shivaji Chowdhury. 5 years back, I sustained a fall during our batch picnic. Shivaji, along with some other friends, took me to his hospital. X-ray showed completely displaced femoral neck fracture. All of us had entrusted Shivaji for doing the operation. Shivaji told me that he is not going for total hip replacement. He will do fixation in his own innovative technique. You have just listened. 2 days later, he did it along with our another classmate, Dr. Abhijit Sarvadhikari. Now, at the age of 69 years, I am fine and doing all sorts of activities and no problem at all. I am really grateful to Shivaji and his team. Thank you all.
Balaram is doing a brisk walking. You cannot tell which side was fractured and which side was operated. The umbrella is one.
This is the same doctor we have operated.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Same doctor. That.
Now can you tell which side has been operated? We can see that tip.
Left side.
Okay. Very difficult to say which side has been operated.
Very difficult to say. This is the unique aspect of this operation. So I am really grateful to these people, KP Chowdhury, an eminent orthopedic surgeon USA, Chairman KPC Group of Hospital, Dr. Saurabh Ghosh, Professor Dr. Rita Pal Chowdhury, she did the most of the cases anesthesia for these cases in prone position, Professor Bhuvan Mohan Pal, Dr. Pratush Chatterjee, Dr. Abhijit Sarvadhikari, Dr. Balaram Sinha, just a gynecologist you have seen, Dr. Jashodhara Chowdhury, my daughter, all anesthetic colleagues of KPC Medical College Hospital, all postgraduate students, all OT staffs. So to end, I take great pleasure in highlighting the contextual relevance of my above work in the present scenario. From the pre-COVID days in India, great thrust has been placed on indigenous, innovative, cost-effective, efficient techniques. In a recent webinar on post-COVID directions of research in science, technology, and medicine, Bharat Ratna Professor C.N.R. Rao has reiterated the enhanced importance of indigenous innovative techniques. This gives me extra satisfaction. I told you this technique does not cost a single farthing more than normal CHS, does not require a blood transfusion. It only takes add 25 minutes to your operative time, and the patient's hip will be as normal as before. So thank you very much for a patient hearing. there is a sunset will be there, the moonset will be there, but there will be sunrise once again. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. That was a very great talk we had today from you, and we have learned a lot. Really, this is a technique which probably should have been propagated more. As a student also, I have heard Dr. Bakshi talking about this muscle pedicle graft. I have seen Dr. Ved Prakash from Hyderabad operating on one of the cases. And also he gave a talk here in Solapur and showed a lot of good results with that. But somehow we have got reservations for doing this. After your talk, I'm sure that we all will start doing it regularly and have our own results to share with you. So let me ask other panelists to have some questions. Yes, Milind.
Sir, that was really inspiring talk. Now, I have a few questions. Have you ever tried this in a case of AVN, maybe because of alcohol or smoking, before the head collapses?
Yes, in AVN, if it is grade 2 or 2B, or an early grade 3, type 3, Fickett Arlett classification, with proper counseling of the patient, we have done tensor fasciolator muscle pedicle bone graft. In that case, we are not going for quadratus femoris muscle pedicle bone graft. Only doing tensor fasciolator muscle pedicle bone graft. That with tensor fasciolator muscle pedicle bone graft, we can delay the occurrence of the total hip replacement. In my experience, I am doing TFL bone graft. In our hospital, I have said in MR Bangur Hospital, one nursing staff, I did her TFL muscle pedicle bone graft 20 years back. She was all right for 20 years. After 20 years, I did total hip replacement in the hip. So, Fickett Arlett stage 4, no point going for any muscle pedicle. But Fickett Arlett stage 1 is not discernible. Stage 2, 3, you can go for this TFL, tensor fasciolator muscle pedicle bone graft. Always. Core decompression, tensor fasciolator muscle pedicle bone graft.
Okay. Now, what is your...
Any other questions?
My another question to you is, how do you know actually regarding whether the graft which you have put, the muscle pedicle graft, has not slipped? Maybe only from the x-rays, say the patient comes to you for follow-up at 4 weeks. Have you ever encountered this finding that the graft has slipped?
In the first slide, I have shown the slide of second slide, Dr. Shailendra Bhattacharjee. Shailendra Bhattacharjee used to keep all armamentarium in his operative trolley. This complication may happen. So, you have to be 100% sure, paraoperatively, that your procedure is secure.
Okay.
If the graft is not secured by mere suturing the capsule, don't hesitate to apply the screw
in
the neck of the femur. If it dislodges from the head of the femur, whole purpose of doing this surgery will be lost. And so, the graft should be 1 centimeter wide and 1 centimeter in depth. If it is less, it is breakable. If it is more, there is chance of injuring of the medial circumflex femoral artery.
Right.
Okay, Milind, before you ask the next question, can you keep your iPad steady? Because it keeps moving and the video will be very difficult to see afterwards.
In your x-rays that you have shown, you have place the graft in the neck, not in the head, and you are fixed with a screw.
It is a 3 centimeter long graft. The width of the insertion of the quadratus femoris in our patient is about 2 centimeter, 2.5 centimeter. It is prolonged proximally, and this part is devoid of, this part of bone is devoid of any muscle supply. You denude of all soft tissue introduced in the head. So, the part of it will be in the neck. In the head, only 1 centimeter. The slot in the head is 1 centimeter. The rest of it in the head. And if there is any posterior comminution in the head, that part will will be also tickled by this part of the bivalve graft. And the very stout, thick muscle quadratus femoris is there. Vascularized, always it will remain vascularized.
Great, your work, such a big work is really commendable because it is unthinkable for these unions to occur, but really a very great work that you have done.
Thank you very much.
Absolutely. The thing which I am actually feeling sorry about is having learned to you and having been able to listen to you so late, but never, it's always better that way, it's never too late. Now we have been actually doing this on a fracture table in a supine position, and we have been actually doing a lot of open reductions also in a quest to have 100% good result and have 100% good reduction. Now I just want to know from you whether it's probably a repetition of the same question as Dr. Dinesh Kale asked you, whether you find it easier to do it in a prone position, because I was thinking that I should be doing a fixation in a supine position and then make him turn prone and do the mayas. That is what I was, because I have never done a open reduction in a prone position.
Sir, first thing, it is not at all an open reduction. I have said only 1% case requires of open reduction. In 180 cases done so far, I have come across open reduction in only 2 cases. So it is about 1%. And we are very much accustomed with this prone position. Very much accustomed. And the crux of the matter, you have to go for the reduction technique first, a little more abduction, correct the varus. Lateral view, proper lateral view in the C-arm and in the fracture table. And if the shaft of the femur sags posteriorly, you push it up. Everything is reversed. If it goes posteriorly, it push it up. And then it will be stabilized in the lateral view. And you have to be satisfied 100% alignment. This is loyal. Reverse S and S is absolutely necessary to avoid non-union.
Yeah, that's it. Now, another question. I have stopped using multiple or 3 cannulated cancellous screw fixation for fracture neck femur, and I have been using a pediatric DHS with another derotation screw superiorly, because I genuinely believe that it distributes the stresses on the shaft also. So I am of the opinion that the fixation is much more rigid with a pediatric DHS and 1 cc screw. Now the success of your surgery depends equally up, not only on the viability of the head, but it equally depends on the secure and rigid fixation. So what is your opinion about 3 cannulated cancellous screws vis-a-vis a pediatric DHS with a 2 hole plate and a additional derotation screw?
Sir, your question is absolutely pertinent. There are lots of papers whether 2 screws are essential, 3 screws are essential, barely use 12 screws. But in my opinion, for last 25 years or more, before that I was not using the muscle pedicle bone graft routinely. 3 screws are, if you place it properly, up to the subchondral bone. If you fix it a little bit proximal to the fracture and not going to up to the subchondral bone, it will fail. And with this cannulated hip screw, with the washer, you can give good compression. And I am not using, my friend Abhijit Sarvadekar is using pediatric DHS, but it is not the podium to show failures of other surgeons' cases. I have seen a lots of pediatric DHS cases. Union has failed and has led to avascular necrosis of the head of the femur. So you have to be very, very sure about your fixation. If the screw proximal part has gone up to the subchondral bone and it has got a good purchase at the lateral cortex of the femur. If the bone is osteoporotic, no fixation will do anything.
Yes, Dinesh.
One question.
Yeah.
Now you, we have got an impacted fracture in a varus position. You have made all attempts to reduce it. It is not reducing. Will you abandon doing your procedure, or you will not hesitate doing a posterior capsulotomy, opening the fracture, fixing the fracture, and then doing the graft?
Impacted fracture
in a varus position
means garden type 1 or type 2?
No, no, the beak has gone into the head where the reduction is not occurring with any maneuver.
Reduction is not occurring with any maneuver. Close, it, close. Sometimes happen, it sometimes happens in garden 3.
Yeah.
When it is partially displaced, head is tilted medially. Then you have to convert it into garden 4 immediately in the operation table. Or you just push and pull the greater trochanter proximally up and down. It will be converted into garden 4. By that procedure, probably you will be able to have a good close reduction. Even if it fails after this maneuver, then you have to go for open reduction. But you convert the garden 3 into garden 4 and the fracture table, operation table.
So the take-home message is you will not hesitate to do an open reduction of the fracture in case you are not satisfied with the reduction.
Yes. Right? Yes. Okay.
Okay. Yes. Because as a pelvic acetabular surgeon, we are accustomed to doing a prone position. We are quite accustomed. The only thing is, would it be advantageous to remove half of the quadratus instead of taking the whole of the quadratus?
It will break, sir. Half of the, it is only 2 cm width for insertion. The length, not length is 2 cm. If you take half of it, it will break.
Okay.
Yes, James said, yeah.
And with the half, you cannot have raw bone to be inserted into the hole made into the head of the femur.
Yes, Dinesh, we
all
are coming
the muscle
back,
is out.
Yes.
Only the part which is denuded of soft tissue has gone inside the hole in the head of the femur.
Yes, Jensen.
Yeah, Professor Chaudhary. So, an excellent presentation and mesmerized by your work. A few questions here. The first one is, you suggested for a TFL graft instead of a quadratus femoris graft in the non-traumatic AVN.
Yes.
What is the logic behind it? What are your reasons behind it?
Actually, if we proceed it anteriorly, we can have a good amount of decompression, core decompression. And in some cases, actually 1% of cases, quadratus femoris may be absent. And if we find it absent after doing it from prone position, quadratus femoris, then we have to do once again anterior position. So double incision, that will be the problem. Otherwise, you can do quadratus femoris muscle pedicle bone graft.
What is your opinion regarding the vascularity or vis-a-vis the quadratus, vis-a-vis the tensor fasciolata graft?
Tensor fasciolata is a very good muscle, very good, thick muscle. There is no problem in tensor fasciolata. But in tensor fasciolata, in most of the cases, you cannot make it very taper. Tensor fasciolata origin is much wider than the quadratus femoris insertion. So you have to take half of the tensor fasciolata, not the full length of the tensor fasciolata. And half of the tensor fasciolata, then a little bit of tapering at the end before insertion, and then you have to fix it with the screw.
So if I
was no problem.
So if I was to take that corollary now, what prevents us from doing that in the traumatic AVNs? Then we are
traumatic AVNs. Yes, traumatic AVNs. There is.
Why do we not do the TFL? Because we are more used to doing them in the supine position.
No, traumatic AVN. Traumatic AVN means it has already AVN has occurred.
No, I'm saying fractured neck femurs.
Fractured neck femur. You are not doing. Fractured neck femur.
Instead of doing the quadratus femoris graft, why not do the TFL?
Not doing the TFL because doing TFL is a rather messy operation. If you have the experience of doing both TFL and quadratus femoris, I'll say I have done almost about 20-25% of TFL muscle pedicle. TFL is always a rather messy operation than quadratus femoris muscle pedicle. This is number one. Second, if there is some posterior comminution or posterior loss of bone, as we find in the lateral view sometimes, that quadratus femoris graft will address that part also.
Sorry, can we have that again?
If there is some posterior combination or a little bit of bone loss in the posterior part of the neck of the femur, that quadratus femoris graft will address that condition also.
Yes, I think that answer is should answer Jayan's question. Normally, the posterior part is getting crushed. So, yes.
Yeah, but I thought we were not opening the fracture.
You had not opening the fracture. But that part is, we are proceeding towards the capsule of the joint and gamella superior inferior on the upper side, and that part is medial. The part of the neck of the part is almost just little bit of capsular attachment and soft tissue attachment there, and the graft is lying there. You know, with the graft secured in the head of the femur, it is going to address the combination, posterior combination of the neck of the femur, even without opening the fracture site.
Like a buttress.
Yes. Yeah. Professor Sivaji, is there any data available between the difference or vascularity of the rectus femoris graft and the quadricep muscle pedicle graft?
Rectus, I have no idea of rectus femoris graft. I am not doing at all rectus. Sartorius graft, I have seen others doing. I have only accustomed to doing tensor fasciitis graft for non-traumatic AVN. Yes. And for fracture neck of the femur, I always routinely doing quadratus femoris.
Okay. One of the case you showed where there was an AVN, Dr. Paul's case, the screw you had passed and there was AVN. What was done to that patient? Was it THR was done?
Yeah, okay. THR was done. Okay. And I said that he was 43 years old, mission. He is like going to have 2 THR in his life.
Yes.
And has shown the plight of the patient having 3 THRs, and the last one is from the huge THR.
Okay, Jayant, Dinesh, or anybody has a question? Otherwise, I'll show one or two cases. Yes, Dinesh, you had some question, I think. Okay. Okay. Just now I received on WhatsApp X-rays from different people. So I'll share one of them. This is a case just 2 days back. You can see 21st of June. Dr. Munish Goel from Gujarat has sent me this X-ray. So what you will do? I know you will be doing...
How old is this patient?
I think it's the age. I forgot. Let me have a look where it is.
Okay. I found his Sphinx osteoporotic index is like 6. Okay. Almost 6.
Yes.
And it is a garden 3 fracture. A garden 4, not 3. The head in the normal position and there is proximal migration of the distal part.
Yes.
So, shaft, it is a garden 4. And I'll do close reduction, internal fixation, muscle pedicle bone graft.
Okay. So this is what his plan was. His questions were a little different. 20-year-old male, 20-year, with transcervical fracture neck, femur, Powell's type 3 or Gardens type 4. Please advise method of reduction, implant of fixation. I want to do the best as the patient is a laborer.
Method of reduction, I have already told in the fracture table. We fix the both feet and give longitudinal traction in 30 degree abduction.
Okay.
That will correct the varus. Yes. And after correction of the varus, you do the lateral X-ray. And if you find the shaft has gone posteriorly and you push it proximally, it will go anteriorly. Yes. So by that you can achieve the reduction and fixation. As one has advised, that he has doing pediatric DHS or multiple. I'll go for V-shaped manner, 3 cannulated hip screws.
Okay. His plan is a multiple cancellous screw fixation.
Yes. Okay.
Or a DHS with a CC screw.
Multiple cannulated screw.
Okay. Now I'll show
the muscle pedicle. He asked him to show see the video and he will be able to do the.
Yeah, that's what. He has already operated. So I would like to share the picture he has shared with me. This is just how he has shared the picture. Operated today only.
Operated today only.
Yes. So, any comments on this reduction and fixation?
Nicely reduced and nicely fixed. There is nothing.
Okay. Now, on another group, just now, half an hour back, I got a picture. Transcervical fracture with subtrochanteric fracture. Have you seen a fracture like this?
I have seen. But that fracture shattered. I'll tell you the story.
Yes.
He has a road traffic accident.
Yes.
Open fracture of the both bones of the leg and fracture of the mid shaft of the femur.
Okay.
So my junior and everyone was satisfied with that. So we did for tibia just fibular plating because the tibial side was soft tissue injury was there. And femur, we did a interlocking nailing. While doing the proximal part fixation, interlocking screw, find there is a femoral link fracture.
Yes.
So it is gone. In the interlocking nail, the diameter of the nail in the proximal part is 13 to 15 mm. So with that big diameter, you are not going posteriorly, not going anteriorly. How can we fix? Somehow we could manage the fixation and then added the muscle pedicle bone graft. Luckily, the fracture of the neck of the femur has united.
Yeah.
In this fracture, I'll do a very long DHS, very long DHS, pediatric DHS, very long DHS because it is a subtrochanteric fracture. It's almost 10 whole DHS.
Sir, with the fracture, neck and subtrochanteric fracture are so nearer. How these fractures like this can happen? Because normally we see shaft little down and the central fragment will never be so small because mechanism of injury, I'm really with it so high. High traumatic injury. That's what. Any comments on that?
It is a motorbike accident injury. Okay. Most likely.
Okay. Most likely.
Motorbike
accident. Okay. You said you will be doing a long DHS with the muscle pedicle bone graft. Yeah. Okay. This is one of the answer given by Dr. Naveen Thakkar on the group. He has said the reply. It's a bifocal fracture, needs nailing with a missing nail screwed additionally, or if required, nail plus joystick reduction with an anterior pin in the head, temporarily fix the neck fragment with intermediate fragment, then reduction of the first block and with the shaft, then entry is made for the nail, and third screw, and nail it with the third missing nail screw or a plate. This is what he has said. Okay. Any other questions? Ashok or Neeraj?
Yes, sir.
Yes, okay, yes. Any questions?
No, currently not on my end.
Okay.
Right now.
Okay.
Because
then,
we are not live, so.
Yeah, I know. Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Professor Shivaji Chaudhary. That was an excellent talk, and I know this will revolutionize the treatment as this video will be available on Ortho TV, and many people will watch it once we share it on live on the group. And I would also like to thank Dr. Dinesh Kale, Dr. Milind Joshi, and Dr. Jayant Sen to share their time with me in asking very pertinent questions. And last but not the least, Dr. Neeraj Bijlani and Ashok Shyam for the wonderful job of coordinating this beautiful platform for the sharing and spread of the knowledge. Thank you very much. And
sir, last one comment, sir.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you
yes.
Load a complete video on the YouTube. It's a very good
video. Sir. Video is with you, sir, Dr. Shiv Shankar.
Yes, sir.
You upload in the YouTube in my name. I have no objection.
Yes.
No,
okay. Yes.
And the question: someone has said that very late presentation. Yeah, had it been done earlier, we'd have been much more benefited. And
yes.
I tell you the irony. It was for Golden Jubilee Oration in the Indian Orthopedic Association, but. It was shortlisted and then was rejected. So I didn't have the opportunity. You are very kind enough that you have given me this opportunity to show these results and this very good technique. And now my colleagues, junior colleagues, are all doing this muscle pedicle bone graft for their routine cases.
Great.
Excellent.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Ashok, you can stop recording.
All the best.